Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is a statement by Michael Matheson on ScotWind Offshore Wind Leasing Round. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement and hence there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today I'd like to update Parliament on the outcome of the ScotWind Leasing Round, a major milestone in our journey to net zero. ScotWind will provide us with enough power for every home in Scotland, place Scotland at the forefront of the green hydrogen revolution, and allow us to become a major exporter of clean energy. There is a huge economic prize on offer, at least £1 billion of investment for every gigawatt built, which will help to create thousands of jobs and transform the Scottish economy. This is the first offshore wind leasing round held since the devolution of the Scottish Crown Estate and has been administered by Crown Estate Scotland, who announced winning applicants yesterday. ScotWind was created with delivery at its core. It was established with the aim of creating a strong pipeline of projects that would drive a just transition and serve as a cornerstone in delivering our commitment to tackle the climate crisis. We put this challenge to the market, and the market has responded so positively that Crown Estate Scotland has been able to offer awards for 17 major projects. This is a tremendous vote of confidence in Scotland. The levels of ambition shown by the market recognises the seriousness of Scotland's commitment to achieving our net zero targets and sustainable economic growth. In particular, ScotWind is by far the world's largest commercial round for floating offshore wind and breaks new ground in putting large-scale floating wind technology on the map at gigawatt scale. This is encouraging to see the ambition that has been set out by the provision of floating offshore wind. As you may be aware, Presiding Officer, our seabed is considerably deeper than waters in England and Wales, and without technology such as floating wind, it would not be possible to develop renewable energy projects in these areas. It is therefore inspiring to see the tremendous rate of innovation in this technology and what more could be possible 10 to 15 years from now in this fast-moving and growing sector. Likewise, many of the consortia successful in securing lease options have ambitions for green hydrogen. This presents a range of new energy and export opportunities for Scotland and will help us achieve our ambition of generating 5 gigawatts of renewable and low-carbon hydrogen by 2030 and at least 25 gigawatts by 2045. We will be considering these opportunities and what this will mean for our energy system further in our energy strategy and just transition plan later this year. ScotWind will also deliver around £700 million in revenue to the public purse for these initial awards alone. We've already made clear that we will invest from these monies to help to tackle the twin climate and biodiversity crisis. But in addition to these revenues, ScotWind promises to deliver billions more in rental revenues once projects become operational, to be invested for the benefit of the people of Scotland. Importantly, ScotWind promises to be transformational in delivering wider economic supply chain benefits to help power Scotland's green recovery the length and breadth of the country. As part of the bidding process, all applicants had to submit a supply chain development statement outlining how they will deliver benefits to Scotland. I welcome the commitment made by developers to invest at least £1 billion in the Scottish supply chain for every gigawatt generated via ScotWind projects. The supply chain development statement, a mechanism that was developed through engagement with the Parliament, provides us with an excellent tool to ensure that, working with the sector, Scottish communities reap the maximum possible economic benefit from ScotWind projects. These statements are not only an indication of what Scotland can achieve, they are our expectation of what the winners will deliver for Scotland. We must now work together to ensure this happens. As highlighted in the Strategic Infrastructure Assessment for Offshore Wind, which was commissioned by the Scottish Offshore Wind Energy Council, there needs to be greater collaboration between developers, the supply chain and the public sector, both to help focus activity and investment in Scottish ports and help Scottish suppliers to grow and win offshore wind work. We work closely with SOEC to implement the five key recommendations in the Strategic Infrastructure Assessment, starting with the creation of a Scottish floating offshore wind port cluster, with ports acting in partnership to provide the required infrastructure area and capability needed to attract manufacturers to invest in Scotland. To help achieve this, SOEC is leading on the development of a collaborative framework to encourage the sector to come together and work collectively to support the delivery of offshore wind projects from ScotWind, with a focus on growing capability and expertise, particularly around the growth of floating offshore wind. We fully support the creation of the collaborative framework, and we expect the successful ScotWind projects to actively engage in this process from the outset, and to take collective action not only to grow Scotland's supply chain, but also to help deliver the wider economic transformation that will benefit communities across Scotland. To that end, the scale of the winning bids augurs well for creating the volume of sustained demand that will mark a step change in developing the capability and capacity of Scotland's infrastructure and its manufacturing and service sector. We are at the start of a journey which will take some years before we see these developments constructed. As well as supply chain opportunities, the focus now switches to the planning and consenting regimes, ensuring that these work as effectively as possible as we process applications from developers and the potential that can be delivered in light of environmental and other impacts. Clearly, the stated collective aspiration of the projects which have been awarded options are highly ambitious, and this is to be welcomed. ScotWind will make Scotland a global leader in offshore wind energy, and all the consortia holding options are fully aware of the responsibilities that come with the development opportunities they have won. However, ScotWind will also be shaped by our continuing commitment to responsible stewardship of our incredibly rich natural marine resources, as well as the need to fully understand the impact on other marine users. We work with sectors and with all affected stakeholders to ensure this process and its benefits are realised in a manner which recognises the concerns of all interests as we embark on this journey. It's not possible at this stage to predict what scale of development will be permitted, but through our internationally recognised sectoral marine planning and licensing process, there is an established pathway to facilitate development. By following due process, taking into account all stakeholders and consideration about impact, the Scottish Government can maximise the huge opportunities for energy, for the environment and for the economy that the large-scale development of offshore wind can bring to Scotland. Signing officer, these ScotWind awards are a phenomenal mark of confidence in the Scottish offshore wind sector. We are now the biggest offshore wind market in the world and demonstrating global leadership in tackling the climate challenge. However, the real work starts now. Tomorrow, the First Minister and I will hold a summit with all of the successful parties. We'll be clear in stating our expectations to all involved. I will also meet successful developers, both collectively and individually, on an ongoing basis to understand how we can work together in a collaborative manner to deliver the best for Scotland. In addition, the Minister for Environment and Land Reform is meeting today and tomorrow with marine environmental interests and with fishers to ensure that their perspectives and concerns are taken into account. This, Presiding Officer, is a once-in-a-generation opportunity which has to be realised, has to be maximised and has to deliver the environmental and economic benefits for all of the people of Scotland.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement, and I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Conservatives welcome the announcement on ScotWind as we look to drive the UK forward in our collective ambitions to achieve net zero. What is particularly notable is that what we might call big oil is at the forefront of this drive towards renewable energy. Indeed, of the £700 million expected to be raised, they're paying nearly £240 million. BP have set Aberdeen as its global ops and maintenance centre of excellence for offshore wind. Total Energies reckon the west of Orkney could deliver renewable power to hydrogen power to the Flutter Hydrogen Hub. But this is an industry much maligned by many who failed to see the pivotal role it would play and took positions which could discourage investment and forward planning. So, Cabinet Secretary, what diligence has been done on the successful bidders to ensure that they can deliver and that they have sufficiently strong balance sheets to deliver that £700 million? And then there's the supply chain. It's not lost on me as a North East representative that 70% of successful bids are within 100 miles of Aberdeen. But given that only once agreements are officially signed will the details of the supply chain commitments in the supply chain development statements be published, how will the Scottish Government ensure maximum benefit to our local and UK supply chains and ensure jobs, manufacturing and the like remain in the UK? And finally, Crown Estate Scotland's website says that capital from sales is reinvested in new opportunities to strengthen the value and revenue earnings of the estate. Cabinet Secretary, what happens to the £700 million raised? Whose budget does it augment? And for what purposes can it be used?
Cabinet Secretary.
Mr. Officer, I'm grateful to the member in welcoming the outcome from ScotWind and recognising the huge economic opportunity that it creates. He makes reference to the oil and gas sector, a number of which of those who have secured lease options are major oil and gas companies. And that's to be welcomed. This is oil and gas companies making the transition out of hydrocarbons into renewable energy. That's exactly what the Scottish Government has been encouraging them to do. And that's exactly the engagement I've been having with them, is all about helping to make sure that the transition from a hydrocarbon-based economy in Scotland and the northeast of Scotland in particular is one which ensures that those who are in the oil and gas industry have an opportunity to move into a renewable sector. Therefore, the success of some of these oil and gas companies is to be welcomed on the basis that it allows staff within their organisations to make that transition and to utilise the very considerable skills that our oil and gas sector have, particularly in the subsea sector, which will be really important in helping to support the development of some of these projects. So that's a positive and it's a welcome step that is being taken. In relation to the member's reference to due diligence on the basis on the ability of these organisations to secure these particular lease options, it is worth keeping in mind is that at this stage it is a lease option. They still have to get consent and they still have to get planning for the development to take place. And I'm sure the member will recognise that in order to achieve that consent, they will have to go through the financial disclosure process in order to secure that. So I think it's too early in this stage to say what is the balance sheet of them, but I think if you look through the list of those companies who have secured lease options through ScotWind, they're all companies who are internationally operating within this particular field and committed to investing in oil and gas, in the renewable sector, including those in the oil and gas sector. And then his final point in regard to the £700 million, we've made very clear that that's money which will come into the Scottish Exchequer. It's funding which we will then use in part to help to support our net zero ambitions, and we will then consider how we utilise that across the rest of the Scottish Block Grant. The other thing I think it's worth keeping in mind, because there's been some incorrect commentary over the course of the last 24 hours, where people think that the £700 million is it. There isn't. It isn't the case. There's actually an ongoing annual rental payment which comes in from those who go on to start producing electricity from these developments. That in itself will bring in a further billions of pounds over many years while the projects are operating. And this money, again, will help to benefit the whole of Scotland.
I call Daniel Johnson. I don't call Daniel Johnson, I call Colin Smith, although we were advised it was Daniel Johnson. Colin Smith, please.
I'm happy to hand over to Daniel Johnson, but I'll continue. The need in a journey to net zero to fulfil Scotland's huge potential in offshore wind energy is clear, and the award of these licences is an opportunity for the Scottish economy and Scottish jobs, but this time it must not be squandered. History has shown us that if developers can go elsewhere, they will go elsewhere. Just weeks ago, the government sunk plans for a publicly owned Scottish energy fund, and Scotland's seabeds are now being franchised entirely to private overseas owned big multinationals and investment funds, a move I hear welcomed by the Tories. It will raise around £700 million for the public purse, but billions more for firms, none of which are registered in Scotland or owned in Scotland. It's not just a case of offshoring wind energy, but offshoring the profits from it. It cannot also mean offshoring the jobs. The government's record on green jobs is not good. They promised 130,000 a year, but have delivered less than a fifth. So given that supply chain commitments from bidders which remain unpublished were excluded from the auction tender and assessment process, and the penalties for failing to deliver developer statements are negligible, can the Cabinet Secretary tell us what binding action will be taken to ensure that the bulk of the work, not the crumbs, the bulk of the work remains here in Scotland? And surely the Cabinet Secretary knows what percentage of the work will be carried out in Scotland for the benefit of Scottish jobs.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, the Member will recognise the Supply Chain Development Statement was a process that was developed in consultation with the Parliament, given experience in the past. And I accept that we have not achieved the level and scale of inward investment and supply chain development in a renewable sector that we would have wanted to. That's why it's absolutely critical that we maximise the potential benefits from this particular ScotWind leasing round. It is worth just pointing out this is the first ScotWind leasing round. There's an opportunity for further ScotWind leasing rounds in the years ahead. And what I can assure the member is that we'll be doing everything that we can to ensure that those who have stated in their supply chain development statements the level of investment that they will make in the Scottish supply chain, which, as I've stated, works out at roughly £1 billion for every gigawatt that comes on stream, that is delivered, and that is our expectation for that to be delivered. And the process that we have in place with SOEC through their strategic infrastructure assessment and also through the collaborative framework which is being developed are all about maximising that opportunity and doing so in a way that ensures that we reap the economic and the social benefits that can come from such a significant level of financial investment within the Scottish supply chain. And we'll be doing everything we can to ensure that they deliver on the commitments set out in their statements.
Thank you. Before I call the next questioner, can I just ask, please, for more succinct questions and answers? I did give a bit of latitude to front benchers, but we don't have the same opportunity for everybody else. Otherwise, we will simply not get everybody in. I call Gillian Martin to be followed by Maurice Golden.
This announcement unlocks certainty for the developers, operators and the supply chain. Huge investment that creates thousands of jobs. I want to ask, now that we have that certainty, how we will ensure a smooth transition for those working in the high carbon sectors, like oil and gas, who want their future to be in renewables?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I mentioned earlier on, one of the outcomes from the ScotWind round has been the number of oil and gas companies who have moved into the renewable sector, and there's an opportunity there for those who are employed presently in high carbon intensive industries to be able to transition into the renewable sector. And it's important that we make sure we maximise the skills and knowledge within our oil and gas sector in supporting that transition and the build out of the projects which have secured leasing options through ScotWind. So I can assure the member that we want to make sure there's a just transition for those in our oil and gas sector, and ScotWind provides a pathway for us to help to secure us achieving that.
Maurice Golden, to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There is a risk Scotland loses out here. The projects coming through ScotWind, which I welcome, are mostly larger than 1 gigawatt. A big challenge for the Scottish supply chain, unless there's an opportunity to develop and scale up local capabilities, particularly in the North East. But Scottish innovation projects are currently limited by a 100 megawatt cap compared with 300 megawatts for England and Welsh projects. Will the Cabinet Secretary lift the cap on innovation projects within the INTOG planning process, increasing their competitiveness compared to the 300 megawatt projects available to come forward in the Celtic Sea, and providing a vital opportunity for the supply chain to work up its capabilities in advance of ScotWind?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises an interesting point, although I think he's missing one of the key risks from what he's just actually asked. And the reason that the INTOG is capped at the 100 megawatts is to help to support innovation in the sector in order to scale up and support in the decarbonisation of oil and gas, but also to help to prevent it from starting to impact on the ScotWind development rounds, because of the danger of overdevelopment in some areas. Therefore, by raising it to 300 megawatts, potentially compromises ScotWind and its developments. And that's one of the reasons as to why it's been capped at 100 megawatts and why it's different from the approach that's been taken in England and Wales. And it's, as I say, its key purpose is to drive innovation in the sector. And those who are involved in innovation side of the sector are very supportive of the levels which we've set the cap at.
I call Alistair Allen to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Yesterday's welcome announcement will mean that the waters around the Western Isles will contribute substantially to Scotland's journey to net zero and present vital economic opportunities. And I ask the Cabinet Secretary what benefits the Western Isles can expect to see from ScotWind in terms of community benefit and supply chain opportunities, and how will the Government ensure that partners like the local authority are fully involved?
Cabinet Secretary.
Alistair Allen raises an important point for his own constituency and the potential benefits there can be for the developments taking place off the coast of the Western Isles in his own constituency. What I can assure the member is that what we're keen to do is to ensure that all parts of Scotland, including his own constituency, have the opportunity to benefit from the investment which will be made in the domestic supply chain in order to help and support the rollout of the ScotWind projects. I'm aware, for example, in Stornoway there is the deep port development which is planned for there, which could play an important part in helping to support the industry with its build-out as well. But I can assure him we'll be looking to work with all stakeholders to make sure we maximise the economic and the social benefits that can come from the build-out of these particular projects, including within his own constituency.
Daniel Johnson, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. These sites could generate upwards of £6 billion for these international firms, who will pay just £700 million for 10 years' rights to do so. So what does the Scottish Government assess the payback period and the net present value to these corporations for these projects? And does this represent good value for money for the Scottish taxpayer, or are the profits simply being blown offshore?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signed officer, we've had an open auction process which has attracted interest from global companies to invest in offshore renewables here in Scotland. I hope the member would welcome the commitments that they have made to potentially invest what could be £25 billion into the Scottish supply chain, with the potential for a further £10 billion to be invested in the Scottish supply chain. And that is good for the Scottish economy and it is good for Scottish communities as well. In relation to his wider point, I suspect he's making reference to the fact whether it should all be just Scottish or UK-based businesses, or it should all be in public control, public sector control, if we only had those powers in order to do so within the energy sector itself. Because his colleague incorrectly made reference to the Scottish Energy Company, which was a retail company, not a production company, because we don't have the capacity or the ability to be able to do so, or the powers to be able to do so. So I don't know whether the member's now saying that we should nationalise energy because his leader in London said, no, that's not their policy, But what we want to do is to make sure we secure the economic benefits from Scotland, and that's exactly what the supply chain development plans were all about doing. And I hope the member will be able to find it in himself to welcome such a significant investment in the Scottish economy.
Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's hugely welcome that ScotWind will deliver such substantial revenues to the public purse. But for the sake of clarity, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to provide any further assurance to my constituents that these revenues will be invested for the long term to support our transition to net zero?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Officer, we are given consideration as to how this funding will be deployed. And one of the things that we have committed to doing is to make sure that it helps to support us in achieving our net zero ambitions and to tackle both the climate and biodiversity crisis. But we want to also make sure that we use this funding in a way that allows us to have a legacy that can benefit all of Scotland and all communities in Scotland, and to make sure we capitalise on it in a way that has a long-term benefit to every part of Scotland.
Liam MacArthur, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. ScotWind represents a sea change in realising Scotland's offshore wind potential. It also underlines the importance of our islands, along at the forefront of renewables innovation in delivering our net zero ambitions. Following on from the response to Alistair Allen earlier, can the Cabinet Secretary give assurances that rather than a top-down approach, local communities will indeed have control of the decisions about the way in which these funds are invested? And what assurances can he give about the involvement of other stakeholders, notably the fishing industry, in shaping how each development is now taken forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Presiding Officer, the guiding light on any of these developments is the sectoral marine plan, which is part of which takes into account the consenting process and how any stakeholders should feed into that process. So I can assure the member that those within the fishing community that want to make representations in relation to any development will be able to do so through the normal consenting process. And those voices and those views will be taken into account through the normal process for considering these issues. In terms of how the funding will be utilised, I'm sure the member will recognise the very significant amount of funding that this brings into the Scottish Government. And what we need to do is to make sure that we utilise that funding in a way that ensures that all of Scotland gets the benefit of that, including coastal communities like his own constituency. And I can assure him that we'll consider that very carefully and ensure that we utilise the funding in a way that maximises the benefits to all parts of the country, including in his own constituency.
Stuart McMillan, to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. ScotWind certainly does open up the vast range of opportunities, and maximising them for the benefit of our economy and socially is something that we can all agree on. Can the Cabinet Secretary indicate any updates he may have about Ferguson Marine and Port Glasgow becoming the shipyard to benefit from the ships acquired as per the BP Alternative Energy Investments bid?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we recognise that within some of the bidding process that there have been those stakeholders who have been engaging with a range of Scottish supply chain companies, and we will certainly be making sure that they are taking forward the commitments that have set out in their supply chain statements, including those that may be looking at the building of vessels here in Scotland. And I've got no doubt that the member will want to engage with those companies who have made commitments to businesses based in his constituency, businesses which are highly valued in his constituency and provide a lot of employment within his constituency, to ensure that these Tier 1 companies who have secured lease options live up to the commitments that they have set out within their supply statement, within their bids.
Stephen Kerr, to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary seems to accept that the SNP didn't deliver on their economic promise of making Scotland into the Saudi Arabia of wind power, and they didn't deliver on the thousands of jobs that they promised, green jobs that they promised. And the Cabinet Secretary told Liam Kerr and Colin Smith that the government would do everything it can to ensure that we see onshore supply chain development and local manufacturing content and the jobs that everyone is talking about. So what exactly does the Cabinet Secretary mean when he says that the government will do everything we can? And I refer members to my register of interest.
Cabinet Secretary.
You know, the member seems to have quite a short-term memory issue, because he may recall that one of the reasons as to why there was a sudden halt to a certain level of wind development, energy development in Scotland, was because of the UK government's decision to cut the subsidy to supporting the industry, which resulted in a massive downturn within the sector alone. No doubt the member will be wanting to make sure that in the CFD process, which I'm sure he's aware of, the CFD process, which the UK government is responsible for, that it holds up the commitments that they have made to ensure that they help to support the supply chain development. And that's why, for the first time in the UK, we have required through a leasing round the supply chain development statements. And the purpose behind that is to make sure we don't make the errors that the UK government did, who were responsible for the last leasing round, where they made no requirements upon the industry. So I can assure the member we'll be doing everything we can to deliver on these commitments, and what we won't do is we won't repeat the mistakes of his colleagues at Westminster in mismanaging Scotland's oil and gas reserves and its renewable energy reserves, as it has done for many, many decades.
Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thanks. Well, unlike Mr Kerr, I found yesterday's statement absolutely breathtaking. The scale of investment, the scale of increase in renewable energy capacity, the scale of jobs that are going to come to our communities. I think any young person seeing that announcement yesterday would have been inspired as well. But of course, it's important that we also tackle the nature emergency alongside the climate emergency. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what lessons can be learned from the previous offshore consenting rounds to ensure that bird and marine life will be protected?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, President Officer, we have a very robust consenting process that requires that any proposed project has a very detailed environmental impact assessment and wider impact assessment on any marine environment linked to the development. And that process will be applied in all of these particular proposed developments. What we have to do is we need to make sure that as we look to maximise the potential economic benefits of ScotWind, that we also recognise the potential environmental impact that these developments can have. And that's where the sectoral marine plan is the guiding light in these matters, and it's the process which will be used in order to make sure that these projects are properly assessed and that any mitigations that need to be put in place or where it's not appropriate for development to take place at the scale of the ambition that was set out by developers, that we have a consenting process that takes all of these matters into account prior to making any decision on it, including the importance of protecting what is our precious natural environment and ensuring that it is not degraded further as a result of these developments.
And Fiona Hislop.
This is an enormous opportunity for Scotland. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm the three main aims of the ScotWind leasing round: to move quickly to deployment from licensing, to secure supply chain jobs for Scottish companies, and to optimise the auction and revenue payments for the taxpayer have been achieved? And in terms of Scottish supply chain jobs in particular, when will details of the opportunities be public? And what powers does the Scottish Government have to ensure licensees deliver on the proposal for Scottish jobs?
Briefly, please, Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, the Member is correct in these three areas. We have moved quickly with ScotWind. What I can also assure the Member is that we are adding additional resources to the consenting process in order to help to make sure we've got the capacity and capability to deal with the scale of these potential bids. She rightly points out as well about the supply chain statements and the benefits that that will drive for the domestic supply chain here in Scotland, which is hugely welcome, and will be transformative in terms of our green energy sector. And in the financial elements, it's very clear from the outcome from ScotWind is that there are significant financial benefits, not only in the leasing options and also in the rental provision, but also in the investment that will go into our domestic supply chain, which I believe will be transformational in the years ahead. And I would hope everyone across this chamber would support that and get behind the success of the ScotWind bidding process.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the statement, and we will now move on to the next item of business.